Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for standing by and welcome to Visual BI's webinar. Today, we will walk you through our webinar titled Power BI with SAP Integration BW HANA. During the presentation, all participants will be in listen-only mode. If you have a question during the presentation, please submit it via the Q&A portion on the screen. Simply type your question into the box and click the send button. Our presenter will address questions at the end of the presentation, time permitting. If you don't hear an answer to your question today, don't worry, we will deliver answers to you individually after the webinar. The webinar is being recorded and a link to the replay will be sent to you via email. Presenting today is Gopal Krishnamurthy, founder and CEO of Visual BI Solutions, and Satya Karthikeshwar, BI Solutions developer. I will now turn the presentation over to Gopal.
Thank you, Kristen. Good morning, everyone. We have a very exciting topic once again, where we have a number of our customers have reached out to us about how do they best integrate Power BI to their BW data sources or connecting to SAP HANA. And I have here with me Satya, who is from our Power BI COE, who has been specializing and doing a lot of research on this topic to share a lot of the tips and tricks as well as some of the best practices. And I will be here also to moderate and provide some Q&A because there has been a lot of questions over the last several months. And I'm here to just set the stage as an introduction and turn it over to Satya. Satya, if you can move on to the next slide. Since the legal disclaimer, because this is a really touchy topic, we are a partner of SAP and we are a gold partner of Microsoft. We want to make it very clear that we are not recommending a customer to, you know, completely re-platform to Power BI or re-platform to SAP. We are trying to make a recommendation based on the customer has already taken a decision and we are just providing a solutioning to our customer. You are always recommended to consult with either your SAP account executives or Microsoft executives to clarify regarding licenses or any restriction. But Visual BI is just providing us solutions or best practices based on what we know. Just a disclaimer, just because it involves two major software vendors. Moving on, I would like to go to the next slide. And I wanted to talk about the kind of agenda we have today, because this is I will be talking about Visual BI introduction, and we have a fairly deep content over the years. We have had number of questions about, you know, how do I do this, how do I do that, what are that. So Satya will be going over this in detail and demonstrating to you as well. And I would like to go to the next slide and introduce you know, what qualifies Visual BI to be actually be a thought leader in this topic and share this webinar with you. As number of you may already know, Visual BI is a premier partner of SAP and a gold partner of Microsoft, but fairly for the last 1 year, we are actually the go-to partner for Snowflake as well in building cloud data warehouse. But most importantly, as a company, because of our focus, we have close to 300 employees and number of numerous Fortune 500 companies work with us, primarily because of our expertise in consulting services, the depth of knowledge we provide, as well as our software products. And I wanted to share, if you go to the next slide, the reason why a lot of the customers are enamored or they are sticky customers of Visual BI is principally because of our solution or our product offering. Specifically to today's Power BI topic, you know, we have our XViz offering, which is doing very well in the market, which is nothing but your custom visuals for providing advanced features and functionality visualization for Microsoft Power BI. And I strongly recommend you to check out xviz.com, because a lot of times you look at Power BI, oh, it has this limitation, that limitation, and you are not able to deliver the features and functionality. I would like you to check out xViz. The other one is Valque. Valque is for self-service planning and simulation and visualization inside Power BI. And it is also available with SAP Lumira. But what I wanted to tell you is, as a company, we are bringing capabilities that are not available with Power BI as well, like we did with our SAP customers. VBI View is a product that brings multiple BI content, because what has happened is a lot of customers have business objects, they have SAP's Analytics Cloud, they have Power BI, they have Qlik, they have Tableau. So they have multiple BI products and they have no one way to search and consume the BI content. So I would strongly request you to take a look at vbiview.com as well, because these are our offerings that are actually being consumed by more than 200 companies worldwide. And if you go to the next slide, you will get to see the best in the world actually work with us. And you can see the depth and breadth of our customers from all over the world. And I wanted to thank our customers for continuing to trust us. And you know, we get so many new customers every month and the list keeps growing. If you go to the next slide, it's something that I am very proud to say. The company has expanded our offerings beyond SAP to, you know, we started about 2 years back with Microsoft, and today we are a premier gold partner with all our products working with Power BI. We started working heavily with Snowflake and dbt because a lot of our customers want to go to build a cloud data warehouse, and we are the trusted partner for building their data warehouse with Snowflake. A number of customers engages for strategy and roadmap to decide, okay, which backend data warehouse technology or a data lake, or be front end, be Tableau or Power BI or SAP's Analytics Cloud. We are always in the innovative cycle with the customer to help them replatform, to move to the cloud, or deliver hybrid BI functionality. And the most important thing is most of our revenues actually come from our ability to model the data, build the ETL, and build the data warehouse. And that is something that people look at the name of the company as Visual BI, and they simply don't get a clue that why do we have 300 employees? It's simply because of the depth we provide across the spectrum. And that said, I would like to go to the next slide, and I wanted to turn it over to Satya, who is going to focus on the crux of the webinar today. And I will be online to help moderate the Q&A and the poll. Satya, over to you, Satya.
Thank you, Gopal, for the brief introduction about our company. And I would like to again welcome everyone to this webinar from Visual BI Solution End. So let me kickstart the webinar's outline. So this is the agenda for the webinar. I will be initially starting off by giving a brief introduction and history of SAP with Power BI. I will then be walking you through the various SAP connectors in Power BI that is present as a standard connector in the tool itself, how these SAP connectors will vary based on the nature of options selected in Power BI, what are the different connectivity modes available in Power BI. We will then have an overview of the architecture present from SAP to Power BI for both BW and HANA. We will have a walkthrough on some of the governance approaches available in Power BI to make certified data sets, and also how to provide level of security access and resharing capabilities. We will have a check on few parameters on what works and what doesn't from SAP to Power BI. Finally, we will see a quick demo where I will be showcasing a simple calculation view consumed from the HANA database. What are the various options of selection in HANA and how Power BI interprets HANA values in it? So this is the history of SAP with Power BI. Before we start understanding on the connectivity of SAP to Power BI, we need to travel back down in time to understand start of Power BI and when SAP connectivity was introduced in Power BI for consumption. How it has evolved over the years. Power BI was initially introduced in 2013. SAP connectivity made its appearance in 2015 for both BW and HANA. 2016, we saw the connectors go live from the preview mode. 2017, we saw improvements and late adoption of SAP HANA in full-fledged into Power BI. Parameters and variable values from SAP was used. SSO implementation methods were provided out for both BW and HANA respectively. 2018, we saw high improvements on the SAP HANA side. Also, we were able to enable defaults from the SAP system to Power BI on the variables aspect. 2019, this year, we saw improvements and the introduction of the ability for end users to change variable consumption on the Power BI reports. And by end users, I mean once the reports have been deployed onto the Power BI service. There are a lot of improvements that have been provided out and adoption of SAP on its cloud service for the past years. And we do hope this is continued out for the years to come. So let's kickstart out the very first topic of SAP connectors in Power BI. I will be talking about both the BW and HANA connectors that are present in Power BI. I will also be telling about the different modes of connectivity that's present for BW and HANA respectively, and what are your options and how do you go forward with it. So the very first connector that we are going to be seeing is the SAP BW connector in Power BI. We have a very straightforward connector that is present inside Power BI. One will be with the application server, where the other will be the message server. Message server provides the user with the ability of load balancer by specifying the logon group. Or you would most commonly go with the application server, where the user points out to the server ID, the system number, and the client ID. You have the two type of modes that we'll be discussing. One is the import and the direct query. BW saw the implementation of 1.0 initially and 2.0. So we will also be discussing this in the architecture and the overall diagram of BW connectors. So talking about the connectivity modes in Power BI for SAP BW, we have two modes that are present. One is going to be the import and the other is going to be the direct query. Import is quite straightforward, where we take the instance of the data from the database and we store it into the system. So what we need to understand on the import is that the data set snapshot is taken from the database into Power BI. So logically, Power BI is going to take up storage of the user. And once data compression and all techniques take place and it gets stored, we then transfer the report along with the data set to the Power BI service. So when this happens, the user is going to get occupied by the data set limit. So let's just say if you have a data set, there is some occupants that's going to happen on the data level, and you will see the storage is going to change from your 10 GB. It's going to get consumed with a certain limit. Whereas when you talk about the direct query mode, it's going to be a live connection mode, and you're going to see a lot of RFC calls that happens back and forth from the Power BI to the database. So for each and every click, any change on your report, there is going to be an RFC call that's done back. And you're going to retrieve the values out from your database to the front end. We need to note that this is not like the import mode, where we don't see a physical data set copy. So everything that's coming is happening from the database, and the performance of the report has a dependency on the database performance. So this is the overall structure of the BW connectors that are present in Power BI. So initially, Power BI started off with the 1.0 connector late in the 2016 to 15. So we had the direct query and the import mode. So as I discussed, direct query is going to have a live connection. But when you are going to consume this in the direct query mode for the BW connector, we need to understand that there's only going to be one source instance per report. So you will not be able to connect to any other views or BEX queries underlying. So direct query will only offer for one instance. Whereas when you talk about the import mode, it's going to take out the data set completely and it's going to store it. But at the same time, you will be able to connect to multiple instances or to multiple BEX queries underlying. So later we saw something called as the 2.0 connector that was released out by Microsoft for Power BI. This was a very good improvement in terms of the performance that happened from 1.0 to 2.0 for the BW. We again did see we have the direct query and the import. So this is again going to follow the same principles that 1.0 connector had. Direct query is going to have a live connection with only one instance, whereas the import is going to take up storage space and you can have multiple instances. So this is an overall architecture view from the top layer, where we see the underlying data objects like InfoCube, ADSO, multi-provider InfoSet virtual objects are going to be consumed. So what we need to understand on the BW layer is that you have something called as the MDX processor. So logically, what this MDX processor does is that, let's just say you have an info object, and the info object is going to have two primary values. One is going to be the field name and other one is going to be the key. So how Power BI interprets all these inputs is that it takes it as two separate values. One is going to be the field and the key name. Plus, it's going to take out all the info object properties. So each and every property that gets defined for an info object is going to get segregated out, and you're not going to see this as a single entity now, but as separate entities that comes under properties, plus you have the field name and the key. So this is considered as much as a limitation when you want to see something where you have the value and the key, but you have the value and the key, plus you have something like a currency. So it's not going to come along with as the same field, it's going to get separated out altogether. So this is one of the limitations that comes around with the BW connection due to the MDX processor. We can consume all the underlying objects that, such as the ADSO and the InfoCube and all such objects through a BEX query by designing it through a query designer. When we talk about the applicable objects in SAP BW to Power BI, we have the BEX queries that helps us in exposing all the underlying objects. The storage objects such as the ADSO can be consumed via the BEX. Composite providers can be pushed to the BEX. InfoCube can be directly seen onto the Power BI. And if you notice on the right-hand side, we have a table that indicates each and every object that gets shown out into the Power BI on the Get Access or Get Data tab. So each and every object has a meaning, and what it is has been shown out on the tabular column on the right. So when we move on to the HANA from the BW, HANA has a very straightforward connector in Power BI, and it's going to be a very single connector. So for the HANA, you have to just provide out your server details, and you need to connect out to the port number. You again have two type of connectivity modes. One is going to be the import and the direct query. But the advantage on the HANA is that you will be able to put out SQL statements. So you can define custom SQL statements to be pushed from the Power BI to the database of HANA. Also, if you notice, HANA has two type of modes in Power BI. Not about the import and direct query, but as you can view the database tables as a multidimensional or a relational. So this is something that I will be showcasing out in the demo in the future slides. So when you talk about the connectivity modes again in HANA, we have the import and the direct query. Import again is an instance of the data from the system. It's going to occupy the storage. Direct query is again going to be the live connection. RFC calls are going to happen from the desktop to the database. This is the overall structure of the HANA connectors. So for the direct query, as I mentioned, you have the multidimensional and the relational. So there is a lot of difference when it comes to the multidimensional relational, and I will be explaining out each and every parameter that has a change on the data set and how it's going to behave with Power BI. When we consider the import mode, it's again a straightforward thing where we take the instance and it gets stored onto the Power BI. We take out the values and we can model it. So even on the modeling capabilities, there's going to be a lot of difference when we see for multidimensional and relational. This is an overall overview of the architecture. We have all the underlying objects like ODSO view, composite provider, we have the ADSO. All these can be consumed into the calculation views, and we can also put out with table functions, and all these will be respected and pushed out. The major advantage of HANA is that it's going to give out a lot better performance compared to the BW, purely because of the columnar search storage. We do have the OLAP connection that gets pushed into Power BI, and we can definitely see a lot of improvements in the performance when we see compare it with BW and a HANA system. Couple of HANA objects that are applicable in Power BI. We have all the three views, that's the attribute view, analytical view, and calculation view. So all these three views are going to get respected. We can also consume CDS views over here on HANA. Again, the representation is going to be the same as of BW. So, as I said, we had the multidimensional and the relational model. So there's a lot of difference when it comes to the multidimensional and relational, as you can see. So a couple of parameters like, you know, calculated columns, DAX usage, or even viewing the data itself from the underlying calculation view. Multidimensional is not going to offer you all these things. And when you talk about relational, it's going to be really flexible considering to multidimensional. The only major difference of the relational and multidimensional is that the parent-child hierarchy is not respected on the relational, whereas multidimensional will be able to take out the hierarchies correctly and will be able to showcase it out into Power BI. I will show you on the HANA Studio how we have created a simple hierarchy as a parent-child relationship and how it's getting consumed in Power BI. SQL statements cannot be used on the multidimensional level, but relational will respect this aspect. one of the biggest disadvantages when it comes to the multidimensional is that you can consume only one calculation view. This is a very big limiter, but again, it depends on the type of project that the organization takes up. When it comes to the relational, one of the biggest advantages that you can use multiple views. When it comes to multiple views or multiple tables, you have the option to enable relationships within your Power BI desktop model. So you can connect all these views or tables with different relationship and cardinality, and you can perform joins too. Plus, you have the ability to make out row-level security on the relational model. So let's talk about the governance approach of SAP Source and Power BI. So most of our customers that approach us for the Power BI, we get this question telling, how do we approach on the governance? What should we do to secure our data? What are the aspects of security levels that we need to consider in Power BI? So I will be running you through all the levels of security that's present in Power BI, right from the database to the very end of the Power BI service where users consume it. This is a very important portion in our webinar where organizations need to understand what is the best approach they need to take. And we will guide you through now so that you get a brief underlying layout on how the governance should be approached. To kickstart on the governance approach, it's going to be the levels of restriction. So as I said, the database is going to have the first level itself of the restriction in data. This is purely based on the user that's created on the HANA or the BW system itself. Based on the user's credentials, HANA database is going to filter out the data. And this filtering out happens through analytical privileges or through BW authorization objects, depending if it's a BW or HANA database system. So based on those values, the user is going to get his or respective rows of data set values. This gets pushed to Power BI. So Power BI, again, this credential access happens on the Power BI through the get data option in Power BI. Power BI asks for the user's credentials initially so that it hits to the database and gets the respective data. This data gets now dumped onto the Power BI system. And over here on Power BI, you have the ability to create row-level security. Row-level security is one of the key aspects in Power BI in order to give out security on the report level. So you have the user principal name, you have a couple of functions on DAX that help you with this. So again, governance is an approach where you see what is the best way we take out and give you security on the row-level part. So moving on, we create the report and we push it to Power BI service. Power BI service, what it does is it takes and inherits all the roles that were created from the row-level security, and it is kept over here. So the admin has to administer or give out the group names or the usernames to the respective roles. Respective roles will respect the security that's given out via DAX, and we will see the restricted data values on the Power BI service. When we talk about the users inside the organization, again, it's going to vary in two ways. One is going to be, what are the type of users that are going to see this kind of data? So that restriction is respected by the role level security. And second level is going to be on the workspace itself. There are people who would be having access to the workspace. So on the workspace level, you have four type of restriction. One is called the admin. The second is called the contributor. Third is a member. And fourth is just a viewer. So Power BI clearly offers you all the restriction on the data set. And this is something that the organization must take into account on how they want to approach and where do you want to keep the restrictions on. There are a lot of possibilities in terms of the import and the direct query. I will be showcasing that to you on the demo. So when it comes to the direct query, the very first question the organization come up with, how do I enable users to directly access the query on the direct query mode? And I want them to get the data that is respective to them. So the single sign-on is the answer over there. So what Power BI does is that you have two possibilities of single sign-on. One is the Kerberos constraint delegation, and the second is going to be the security assertion markup language, simply called as SAML. So for the SAP BW, it's going to be the Kerberos, whereas the SAP HANA has two possibilities of Kerberos or SAML, depending on your underlying architecture. So this has been recommended out by SAP and Microsoft. It has been certified, and you have to take out the account of approach, whether it's going to be Kerberos or SAML for HANA, based on your underlying architecture. So how Power BI takes this out is that it considers the user principal name. User principal name is nothing but the username ampersanddomain.com. This value is considered and it's passed out to the gateway that is placed on the Power BI service level. It then acts on the Active Directory from the Windows to the SAP AD and then pings back the dataset values. So this is a governance approach that I will be showcasing out in the next coming slide on the gateway. So how does the SSO work? As I said, you have the user principal name. You're going to get it from the domain.com value. This gets passed on to the gateway and we see when it hits the database, it's going to check out the Active Directory. Based on those values, it's going to fetch it and give you the respective data sets, addressing the security concerns and also respecting the security from the underlying data set when you're in a direct query mode. So we did a couple of research and we tried understanding how the authorization was working. So when we took out SAP BW, we do see the BW authorization objects and roles. So we did a couple of tests to check on parameters on different levels. First would be the dataset itself completely. Second, we saw it on the info object and the key figure and hierarchy respectively. So we split this into two parts. One would be the PBI desktop itself. Initially, when the user imports or connects to the database to get the data. And the second was once when we published it to the online, that is the Power BI service, the cloud, how were these restrictions or authorization being respected? So this tabular column gives a pretty clear understanding on where and which parts were respected and which was not. So hierarchies was definitely something that was not respected out when it was pushed to the PBI online. And initially when it was given out to the import itself, we did see the authorization objects failed. So this tabular column gives a clear understanding on this. When we saw it for the HANA authorization also, we saw the similar behavior that happened on all the four parameters. We did see the different levels like SQL and normal custom value were on the SAP HANA security analytical privileges. So when we talk about the data gateway and refresh options, this is a very important piece where data gateway is something that's given out by Microsoft itself for Power BI. Data gateway enables the respective users to log in. And this is the first initial fence or security gate that's present in Power BI when you're connecting your user to your underlying database from Power BI service. You have four options on the advanced settings, such as to give the Power BI data gateway as organizational, or you can retain it as private, push it to public, or give it as none. So data gateway is a very important piece and must be configured correctly in your architecture. When we see about the data refresh, primary important thing is that the data gateway needs to be configured correctly. So we're going to see data refresh on two modes. One is going to be the import and the second one is going to be a direct query mode. Data refresh for the import can be pushed on to either scheduled or can be on demand. By scheduled, I mean you can push it to any scheduled refreshing, can be weekly, daily or monthly on the Power BI service level. Query caching happens automatically and on demand, but we need to note that in order for query caching to happen, it needs to be pushed to premium capacity. So premium capacity becomes a mandate. Report visuals filtering does not happen. You need to refresh your report completely. So the three types of refresh that's present in Power BI is on-demand refresh, scheduled refresh, and incremental refresh. On-demand is pretty straightforward, where we have the button or the option in Power BI desktop and service itself. Once you click it to refresh, it gives a complete refresh on the data set. Scheduled refresh, as I said, you can do it daily, weekly, or monthly. Incremental refresh is something that comes under premium capacity, and this is something that has to be configured in order to work. So when we talk about resharing and viewing, one of the critical pieces in the security model, Power BI gives the ability to push it either to a sharing workspace or to a personal use. So you've created your report and you want this to be published or you want this to be kept for your personal use. So when it's on the personal use, you have a personal workspace that's created in Power BI itself on the Power BI service level. So when it comes to the sharing aspect, the collaborating aspect or the pro account usage aspect, sharing workspace comes on different levels. As I said, users who have access to the workspace need to be defined on specific role levels. So let's just say if you are the admin, you have the capability to give specific users who are going to contribute to the project or just going to view the project. So admin is going to have entire access to the underlying reports, data sets, dashboard, and all security under it. Whereas the member and the contributor are going to have options like resharing and making some changes on the setting, but logically or potentially not changing the schedule refresh options and all. Whereas the viewer is only going to have just viewing capability of the report. So role level security, when you talk about role level security, the only type of user that's going to get affected by role level security is going to be the viewers. Admin, member, and contributor will not be affected by role level security. So when you're configuring the role level security for Power BI, it becomes really important to understand that what are the users, what are your type of users, and what is the level of restriction you give them to the workspace. It becomes a mandate also for people to have a pro license, but there is a possibility in Power BI for free users also to consume. The mandate of using a premium capacity comes into picture over here. This consumption of free users to view the reports can be done via apps in Power BI. So we did see in this year, in the August of 2019, SAP Variables was pushed out to Power BI. So SAP Variables was pretty present on, you know, the get data access level itself, initially when the Power BI report is being generated. Now end users have the capability to make these changes. So I'm going to walk you through on what are the steps that are required for you to enable SAP variable consumption for end users to make changes as and when needed in Power BI service. So when you talk about the prerequisite, you need to see that the very first prerequisite is going to be premium capacity should be enabled for the workspaces. Second, it's going to be the SSO, the single sign-on, needs to be configured correctly. Third, you should not be having the relational view enabled for SAP HANA. And the fourth option is you need to enable the SAP variables to be consumed on the Power BI service. So this option is present inside Power BI desktop, and this needs to be triggered before the report is pushed to the Power BI service. You need to have the new filter experience enabled. So I will showcase you what the new filter experience is. So we have a simple report that was pushed out. And if you notice to the right-hand side of the filters panel, that's the new filter experience. It really does not have much now, but eventually when you do put out dimensions inside, you're going to see a lot of options on the filters. If you notice, you have an icon, you have an option called as edit variables. So this is where the end users will be able to select, and you will get a pop-up of something like this that will enable end users to place out values for respective variables. And this gets hit back to the SAP and respective values are pushed back again after filtering. So when we talk about SAP integration with Power BI, we do know that the direct query and import. So we have two options that are given out by Microsoft itself. So what do we go with? So to understand which would be the right approach for organization, either to take a complete data set into Power BI, or we make use or leverage the direct query experience, where we do understand that the database is performance is going to have an effect on Power BI. There are other parameters also that needs to be checked. So let's check that out. So when you talk about SAP BW, some of the common working features that come with the live and live connectivity and the import, we have taken a parameter list that's pretty straightforward and pretty common from the BEX level. We have the characteristic key figures, BEX level restricted and calculated key figures all work fine when it comes to the live and the import mode. Currency conversion, which is going to be static on the BEX level, works fine on the live and the import. But if you notice on the import side, where you see the hierarchies, this is definitely not going to get respected because it's going to come out as a flattened data structure or something more like a relational, where Power BI will not be able to interpret the underlying hierarchies that are defined in the system of BW or HANA. Variable representation of single multiple range does not happen for the import, whereas live will be respected. couple of other metrics and parameters that we check. Live connectivity and import has been shown out. Again, hierarchies is something characteristic or key figure. Whichever level you take it is not going to work for the import. Variable functions like SAP exit, replacement path do not work for the end user on the import level. Live connectivity will adhere to the SAP variable consumption change. Import will not allow that. When we talk about the SAP HANA common working features, all the analytical view, analytical privileges, security gets respected on the live. Import for the analytical privileges to be respected, there is an alternative way to approach this. And this is something that comes as part of the governance approach. When we talk about multiple entries, mandatory variable values, all these do not get respected on the import level. Variable types like single, range, interval all have trouble on the import, whereas the live, it's perfectly fine. Some of the other features, exposable objects, hierarchies, all have trouble from the HANA end. I will be showcasing all this to you on particularly on the hierarchy level for the live and the import. So please do consider for the HANA, we do have two methods. One is going to be the multidimensional and the other is going to be the relational. So we have the direct query and the import mode. I will be showcasing this completely on the demo level. I will be starting off the demo on Power BI. I will initially be showing the HANA Studio where we have designed a very simple calculation view on which hierarchies are enabled. I will be showcasing the hierarchies, how the steps have been present out and how this is being interpreted in Power BI. We will be going through the direct query mode on both the multidimensional and the relational model. So let's push on to the Power BI desktop or the HANA Studio first. So we are currently in the HANA Studio now. And as you can see, I've opened up a simple calculation view that has a couple of fields that have been present out over here. And we do have the hierarchies that have been present out. And let me just open up to quickly show a simple hierarchy on how it's defined. So we have the hierarchy that has the department, period, person, project, and role. So we have defined this hierarchy. Now we want Power BI to respect this hierarchy into the Power BI desktop. So let's again switch back to Power BI desktop now. So we're inside Power BI desktop. So when you're inside Power BI desktop, it is important that to check whether you're going to be on the multidimensional or relational. So multidimensional relational both have its own set of parameters. So in order to check if you're on the relational or multidimensional, let's go to the options and click on options over here. Okay, so you need to navigate from the global to the direct query, and under direct query options, you have to either check or do not check for the relational source. If you do not check, it's going to be under multidimensional, and if you check, it's going to be under relational. So let's just initially start off with multidimensional. In order to select and go to SAP HANA, go to Get Data, go to More. Navigate to database and you should see SAP HANA over here. You need to give out the server details and port number, define it as direct query, and you should be good to go with the database credentials. Once that is done, let me just quickly open up an instance. Let's select direct query over here. Let's navigate out to our respective package. Let's go to the CVC_org data. So the very first limitation or the change you would be noticing is that under the Navigator tab, you do not see the option to select all the multiple fields that I showcased on the HANA Studio. So you cannot manually select any of the fields and you're going to see a single simple calculation view only. So Power BI will not be able to interpret all the values separately and it will give it out as a single calculation view. You do notice that variables are accepted over here and you can make the changes. Optional variables can be included, mandatory will need to be filled out. If you click load, Power BI is now going to make a connection back to the database based on your database credentials and get back the calculation view. Let me open another instance where we have this already enabled. Okay. So we have this instance where I've already pulled in the multidimensional. So as you can see, we have only a single calculation view. We cannot pull in any other. No other calculation views can be consumed. So the very second limitation that we see on the Power BI desktop is that all these options in the Power BI desktop are disabled now. So there's going to be only one single calculation view for you to do. You do also notice that we have only a simple report view that's enabled out. Okay, this is opened up. So let's go back over here. And if you notice that you're going to do every single calculation, every single thing for the report is going to be based on this single view now. I've just created out a very simple hierarchy value. So the very first aspect, if you notice, but we do have this h_no_org hierarchy. This is what is the hierarchy that I showcased out on the HANA Studio. And you notice that on the multidimensional, this has been respected out and all the underlying fields that were given out have been thrown over here. So that's going to be the L static. We have the department, period, person, project, and role. All the hierarchies are respected and it's brought out to Power BI desktop. And this happens only on the multidimensional view. We do notice that we have the chart over here. All the aggregation take place correctly from the back end to the front end. We can also drill down on objects on each value, respective value. Drill down will be respected. We can also place out selection of values and all the values will get filtered out based on the selection that we make. Hierarchies are inherited, as I said, on the multidimensional. Even currency conversion works based on the static level that we have shown on the demo. You will be able to see the unit over here. The values get converted. We have placed out a pretty straightforward static value on the HANA Studio. Conversion gets respected on the multidimensional. When we move to the modeling ribbon over here, we also notice that you have the adding a new measure capability. So Power BI on the multidimensional for a SAP HANA view, you will be able to create further measures and you can place them onto your calculation view, but you will not be able to create new calculated columns or new tables. So when you're not able to create new tables, obviously the point comes where the row level security cannot be done on this. So managed roles, views, what if parameters, Q&A will not be enabled on the multidimensional. So you have a couple of limitations on multidimensional, but yet again, the hierarchies gets respected and a couple of other things also get respected. Let's just have a view on the relational on how it's behaving. So I've opened up another instance where I have clicked it on relational. So we do have the relational calculation view over here. If you notice, there are no hierarchies. This hierarchy was created by myself. So in order to create hierarchies in Power BI, when you consume the HANA from a relational perspective, you need to do this manually and there is no other way. Hierarchies do not get consumed. Parent-child hierarchy is one of the limitations that comes for a relational view on HANA to Power BI. Other aspects such as the drill down and filtering do get respected. You still can have the conversion happening on to the Power BI from the HANA. Hierarchies once manually created will be respected onto the Power BI, but you will have problems on the sort. So sorting has to be done manually on the Power BI level. When we talk about the ribbons and other options on Power BI, if you notice from the multidimensional to the relational, these options are all opened up. So potentially what it means is that you can pull in other calculation views apart from the one that we initially pulled, and you can create relationships. So if you notice, there is another ribbon that's shown out on the left-hand side that's called as the model. So you will be able to place out relationships now and define the cardinality inside. When this happens, you have the ability to create row-level security. So one of the biggest advantages when it comes to the relational and multidimensional is that you will be able to create row-level security over here. Creating row-level security is going to be very straightforward. You need to create a role. And based on the table, you need to place out the field on which you want it. So let's just say we take person. You just need to define out the DAX function that enables the filter. Just select OK and you will have the role created. If you notice, you get a filter symbol over here. depicting the row level security created. So that can be done. You can emulate the row level security that are created on the desktop itself before you publish it to Power BI service. So this is the base difference on the relational and the multidimensional model. It comes down to the organization on the approach that they want to take. Both multidimensional and relational work fine on the Power BI service. Filtering drill down does happen on the Power BI service again. So let's just try going on to the Power BI service now. Okay. So as you can see, I'm on the relational demo mode over here. We have the relational database, drill downs, selection values, everything will be adhered and will be respected. Conversions will still happen. All the basic functionalities that you would be expecting a reporting tool to do, Power BI will be respecting it from the HANA level. It is applicable same to the multidimensional model also. You will be able to see the reports. In order to showcase out the workspace access, what you need to do is just navigate to a workspace. Navigate to a data set just to showcase on the managed relationship. You have this option of managing relationships or permissions over here. You have the option to schedule refresh and enable security. Security tab is nothing but the roles that you consume on the role level security is pushed out over here. And this is where you need to mention out the respective role and the user groups that need to be pushed out for the filtering to happen on the reports. So pretty much the Power BI service, and we just saw a quick demo on the relational and the multidimensional view of HANA. So we did see we have the two options. On the direct query, we have the multidimensional and the relational, or you do have the import mode again. So customers usually when they come up with this question of how do we approach and how do we do or how do we use Power BI, and is Power BI only a visualization tool or can it do more? So this is something that has to be realized by the organization, and the governance setup needs to actually happen first. So do reach out to us for the governance setup. For the direct query and the import, as you can see, you have a couple of capabilities that can be leveraged from the HANA to Power BI. Please do reach out to us on the governance setup. So Visual BI does not just stop over there. We do self-service evaluation on multiple tools like Tableau, Qlik, and we are premium in SAP, Power BI, MicroStrategy, Spotify. So do request out to us for a free assessment to understand how best we can help you out in the approaches. So we are now open for the Q&A. Please do raise out your questions.
Thank you, Saktia. This is Gopal again, and it's actually an excellent content, and I really appreciate you delivering. And I will be kind of moderating the Q&A because there are a lot of questions, and I just thought from a perspective. Saktia, let's go to the first question. I have one of the audience asking, if we have multiple units in a column in VW, how does Power BI understand this? Have we done some R&D on this?
So by multiple units, Gopal, units will take place, and we can get the unit value from the info object. This gets respected onto the Power BI. We will be able to see the units completely.
Now, when I say multiple units in the same query, like you have say one in kilogram and one in pound, or like it's two different unit of measure in two different measures. Maybe this is something we take it up as a blog and we put it on our website, but I think this is a very good question. And as a company, we will get back to you once we have more accurate information. There are questions on performance with direct query. I have multiple users connecting to BW and we have performance issues with direct query. What have we observed?
Okay, so the very first aspect would be, Gopal, is that for the direct query, it directly proportionates to how the database is functioning. So the performance of the database is equivalent to the Power BI report. So if the database has some performance issues, definitely the users are going to see a lot of lag on Power BI. So the improvement on performance from the database side first be checked and addressed. And later, direct query does function well. There is no trouble in terms of the performance per se if the requirements of the database are met to Power BI.
So, yeah, so on the same line, there is a question, especially on SAP connectivity. I have HANA DB, I have Gateway, and I have latency I'm observing in Power BI, but the performance analyzer is not really able to tell me, because it's able to analyze the performance within Power BI. But especially the database, like if you look at BW statistics, it will break it down, database time, the query time, and all that. But the Power BI analyzer is not really telling me is my performance problem on the SAP side or a HANA side. Have you done some exploration on the Gateway side? Have you done some exploration on this?
Not specifically on the Gateway, Gopal, but Power BI's performance analyzer is pretty straightforward only on three steps. One is going to be how the DAX values are getting handled, how the visuals are getting filtered out, how long is it taking for the RFC call to be done. It's really not something that tells stats from the database. It's going to be stats only on the Power BI desktop. So performance analyzer on the Power BI desktop will not alone tell out what are the real stats and how it's getting affected. For example, BEX query needs to be analyzed from the backend itself first and see if the query is performing well. We need to make adjustments on the query for Power BI to interpret it correctly. Best example would be multiple variable consumption. So we need to see where best can we address variables and how efficiently can we use a query. And only then can we use the performance analyzer on Power BI to make our assumptions corrected on with facts.
Okay, I think this is another good block topic about performance analysis outside of Power BI, especially when connecting the SAP sources. We will take it up as a block. There is another question. I really want to use BICS, not the MDX connectivity. Unfortunately, BICS is actually a proprietary connection to SAP. I wish if that was available, then all the tools will perform on par with SAP tools. So the answer is no, he cannot use BICS connectivity. And that is one reason SAP Analytics Cloud will be recommended front-end tool for BW or HANA. It will always do a few things better natively on complex structure, some of the BW security, how it handles, because SAP is hanging on to the BICS as a proprietary connectivity method available only to SAP tools and technologies. There is another question with S4HANA. Is the CDS views S4HANA? Again, I don't see the question more elaborate, but we will have to reach out to you on getting more. One of the things is, how do we extract exchange rates and languages of objects in Power BI, SAP BI? Have you done any research on that?
Unfortunately, no, Gopal, but we can definitely get back to them.
Yes, we will get back to you offline. We have a couple of questions on the SSO. One is on HANA. Do I have to enter the username and password when I'm logging into HANA, when I'm retrieving data from HANA? And same thing on BW, the SSO. We are actually helping a lot of customers in addressing their SSO issues with Power BI. And this is something I will be reaching out offline. And this is something we can definitely address as an SSO methodology and how to do that. There is a question on, can text from BEX queries info be viewed in Power BI, like the text descriptions? Satya?
Yes, we can view it out separately, Gopal. It can be done.
Okay. I think we can take a lot of these questions and respond privately to the audience who is asking this question. And also, we will try to write a blog on it, because I wanted to thank the audience, because a lot of the questions that has been asked are actually very deep and technical, and we really appreciate it. It shows the kind of audience we have attracted to the webinar, and I really wanted to appreciate you coming in. There is time for one more question. I wanted to take it, and then Basically, there is a question on exception aggregation, like average last value min in Bex query. How is it Power BI handling? Do we have access to it?
So aggregations work fine, Gopal, from the backend if it's consumed on the direct query. Whatever aggregations is present from the backend gets respected on the front end. But there are considerations where we use values like non-additive, like ratios and stuff. Those do not get respected, but basic aggregations do happen.
Okay, thank you. And I do wanted to tell you there is a quite a number of questions, and I just in consideration of the time, and I just wanted to make sure I don't miss some questions because I have to skip several questions. And I wanted to thank you all because there are a lot of questions that are like technical know-how. We wanted to take some time and either as a blog or some one-on-one meeting, we will respond to all of you. And I do wanted to thank you for attending today, and we will be in touch. Thanks all. And great job, Satya, in putting together this very complex and very deep integrated topic for our customers. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Gopal.